This is kind of an interesting spot here that I've brought fall camp students to for the past couple of years. I think when most students look around here, they don't necessarily see this as a stand that's been harvested recently or that has had management activity recently. I think most students just see this as kind of an open forest. But if you look around carefully, and I'll walk you around after this video, you'll see some stumps, you'll see some signs of that. And if we look around, I see here's a big Douglas fir, there's another Douglas fir. I'm seeing a lot of Douglas fir, maybe two-thirds or three-quarters of the Douglas fir, maybe even more than that, of the trees that I see are Douglas fir. I see a few red cedars in here, here and there, but there's one species that's missing that I would kind of expect to see here, and that's western hemlock. And so I think I'll turn it over to Cheryl to explain why we're not seeing western hemlock, which mature trees right now.
Right. Okay, so this is a variable retention, and when I say this one emphasizes variable, so there's some, you know, bigger gaps, there's some areas that were hardly touched at all. We were going for a random effect here and quite a high level of retention. So we've left behind on the ground between about 45% and 50% of the basal area that was here before. So we've only removed just enough to get regeneration here. And we've done it in a fairly gappy kind of a way. So you can't even achieve regeneration on all of it. And as Patrick was saying, we've selectively chosen to take out the hemlock. And the reason that we did was they were pretty heavily infected with a parasitic plant, which is considered a forest disease. It's called hemlock dwarf mistletoe. And along with that heavy infestation, it's very common to have secondary fungal decay come on the heels of the mistletoe. And so you had a lot of stem decay as well. So trees were breaking, trees were falling. The hemlock was already falling apart and falling out of the stand. And
when you said secondary decay, do you mean that so the mistletoe were weakening the trees?
Right.
And so the trees were less well positioned to defend against other fungi?
Yeah, and that's very common once trees get to a certain age and they've been living with that parasitic plant for a long, long time. And in fact, I should have mentioned that this stand is about 150 years old. So this is another one that originated from naturally from the wildfire that went through this part of the forest in 1868. Okay. So, you know, it's trees that are, you know, getting well into their mature years. And in the case of the hemlock, you know, which is a shorter-lived species anyway, they're getting relatively old for a hemlock and being infected with mistletoe for, you know, probably their entire lifetime. They were not in good shape. And so what we decided to do was to build this variable retention on the removal of the hemlock component. And then that gives us the opportunity to regenerate and have an interesting kind of a complex silvicultural system where we're going to have a two-age stand in the future, because we still have a really good component. 45% or 50% of the original 150-year-old stand is here, but we've also got this viable wave of understory regeneration.
And when you did the planting, what species did you plant here?
Right. So because of the high level of retention and this is a very, relatively low amount of disturbance, it's really not very suitable for something that's very light demanding like Douglas fir. So I've planted a very small amount of Douglas fir, really more for education and demonstration, and only in the largest gaps. And even then, frankly, I don't expect it to be able to compete well. What's going to do the very best here? The very best, it's good, I predict, and we do have a lot of experience doing these different silvicultural systems, western hemlock. And the real interesting thing is I didn't plant the western hemlock at all. It's naturally seeding in itself, and there are already probably a few young ones down on the forest floor to begin with too. We call that advanced regeneration, that are being released by this. And if you're to look around here, you're going to see some very tall hemlocks already. So this variable retention harvest was done only 5 years ago, and there are already western hemlock here that are well over 3 meters, going on 4 meters tall. So they're well over my head. And that's only in the space of 5 years.
Do you ever plant hemlock on the forest, or do you always rely on natural regeneration?
We have only for very specialized research and demonstration purposes, but operationally, no. There's just no need to. It's just so prolific.
It produces so much seed, and it germinates well, and those seeds
grow well. To be honest,
we
have lots of situations where there is literally too much of it, and it just becomes extremely dense, and you know those stands can take quite a long time to self-thin, and that's what hemlock does. And in fact, in conditions like this, it'll be tricky to get any other species to grow. So what else was planted here? The hemlock were natural. What was planted here is western red cedar and a small amount of western white pine. So those are the main species that we're targeting here. So far, the western red cedar are doing quite well. The white pine is a little bit more experimental at this density. It is moderately shade tolerant, so we'll see how it makes
out. So it might be able to hold on, but this might be a little bit too shady for it to compete against the other vegetation.
Yeah. But even with the cedar and the western white pine, the planters were asked to only plant the larger gaps. So, you know, because of this high level of retention, you know, parts of this stand, you know, are essentially intact. They're like, you know, big, you know, groups of retention or just, you know, lightly thinned parts where you really don't have enough disturbance, enough opening to achieve viable regeneration.
So I know sometimes when you remove a species from a site or you harvest it due to a pathogen or the disease, you can't then replant that species there because if it's a fungus, the inoculum may be in the soil for a very long time, and so if you plant it again, you risk reinfection very quickly. Is that an issue with the dwarf mistletoe?
That's a great question. In this case, no, it's not, because we actually removed all the hemlock, and the way it's a parasitic plant, as I mentioned, and it exists up in the live crown. And so the seed, because it actually is a seed-producing plant, an angiosperm, the seed rains down onto new regeneration. So if there were any infected hemlocks left, yeah, we would just be perpetuating it. But because we took them all out, problem solved. The new regeneration should be free of mistletoe.
Okay, so if you're careful to remove the mistletoe, it's not something that's going to be present in the soil, for example,
no,
so you don't
not
have
at
to
all.
Worry about
it. It can only spread by the seed falling directly from the parent plant onto a green branch of another hemlock tree. So laterally, or very often just from raining down onto regenerating layers. And I just want to say for the record here, I've got nothing against hemlock dwarf mistletoe. It's it's a part of the ecology of these forests, and it's got its own very, very interesting ecology. And as I said, a lot of the things that, are diseases and insects and such, they're agents of diversity in their own right. And there's quite a lot of species that are linked to hemlock dwarf mistletoe that actually have ecological relationships with them. And there's even a red-listed butterfly that depends on the hemlock dwarf mistletoe, which is, it's actually the food for that particular butterfly. So it's not that we want to eradicate it, but it's just that if you do take it out, you really don't have to worry about the regeneration after that.
So was it the issue that the density of it was just too high here, and it was impacting the stand health?
I'm glad you asked. The reason we took out the hemlock here is that between the mistletoe and more so the really severe stem decay that had gotten into these 150-year-old trees, we had trees breaking and falling constantly. And we have a power line that goes through here along this road, and so we were constantly having to remove danger trees that were in danger of falling on this power line. That can be a fire hazard, it can put the power out, it's hazardous for the workers that have to put those lines back up again and repair it all. And we were trying to deal with it tree by tree, and then we just decided to completely rethink it. We said, why don't we make this into a variable retention harvest, eliminate the problem of these hemlock that are interfering with this power line, and have an interesting silvicultural system for education and demonstration purposes at the same time.
Was the decay advanced, or was it early enough that the wood was still relatively marketable?
That's a good question, too. Relatively marketable, okay. Yeah. Yeah, it's interesting because, you know, when you get this hemlock dwarf mistletoe, what happens is sometimes it's growing on living branches, but sometimes it will grow right through the branch slowly over time, and it'll reach right into the stem. And when it grows into the stem, it can cause the wood to grow in a kind of a swelling and be kind of weakened, and that can be an entry place for fungal pathogens. So it had kind of pockets of decay, mm-hmm. and the problem was really just getting underway, but it was only going to get worse and worse. Mm-hmm. And so we did the harvest while there was still, you know, plenty of sound wood left in those trees. Mm-hmm. And so it made sense from an economic standpoint too.
Okay.